Today I'm going to be talking to a very special author who's not only going to be sharing her life-changing books with us, but is also going to be sharing her debut book, Softening the Edge. Welcome to this week's episode of Karen's Bookshelf. Now today I have a very special guest. Not only is she here to talk about her life-changing books, but also she's just recently launched, yesterday, her new book, Softening the Edge, which is all about empathy. Mimi Nicklin, thank you so much. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Welcome to Karen's Bookshelf.
Thank you.
What made you write a book about empathy?
Gosh, it's like the million-dollar question. A couple of things made me write the book about empathy. From a big picture point of view, from a macro point of view, back in 2018, so I had moved here to the Middle East and taken over a business and was busy turning that around, and was very keen and passionate about using empathy, emotional intelligence, people-led leadership to turn that business around. So I was very much in that mindset. And from a macro point of view, I came across two statistics that, I don't know, changed my life, really. One of them was the data that the World Health Organization has around youth suicide.
Okay.
So the second biggest killer of our youth, 16 to 24 year olds, is suicide. And that's pretty chilling, right? That our children...
It's terrifying. It's terrifying. Yeah, yeah.
That our children are choosing to not stay on the planet with us rather than live with us.
Yeah.
So that was one of them. The second was, I have a three-year-old daughter, and I was reading some research around empathy and violence and how those things work together. And I understood that in America, when children turn three or four, the school system has to educate the children as to how to sit on cubicles in the bathroom and lift up their feet so that if a gunman enters the school, he wouldn't know there's a child in there and shoot them through the door. So those two pieces of data, both of them around children and youth, were incredibly poignant for me. And that made me want to write. You know, I love to write. I've always written. I've worked in advertising my whole career. And I just felt like somebody needed to talk about this more. Somebody needed to talk about this empathy deficit and what it's doing to our people. And the book is mainly about the business world. The book is mainly around how do we bring empathy into the working environment, the corporate world, because we spend 5/7 of our week there, Karen. And, you know, if we're unhappy, and over 80% of us are, in 5/7 of our week, again, we've got a problem. Those are some of the things that made me really passionate about elevating the conversation. And then I wrote a book.
Yeah. And we were just talking earlier, weren't we, about everything that's happening in the world, particularly this year, and how relevant this book is and how we should be teaching our children and what, and because if we don't know it, how can we pass it on to the next generation? So I know a lot of people, a lot of readers are educating themselves this year in particular. So this is a great book. You can get your copy in Borders as well. So congratulations again.
Thank you.
Let's talk now about the books that have changed your life and may have impacted you when writing this one. What have you got first?
So the first one I brought was Ogilvy on Advertising.
Yep.
It was bought in England. I took it to Hong Kong with me. Then I moved to South Africa. Then it came to Singapore with me. Now it's in Dubai. Yeah. This is the original David Ogilvy's book on advertising. So he is the
He's the granddaddy of advertising. Yeah.
He was a copywriter like me, or more, maybe I should say I'm a copywriter like him.
Yeah.
A deep believer in human behavior and insight and research. And it is ironic that all these years later, 15 years later, in my career, lots of what he's talking about is in my book in very different ways. You know, Ogilvy talks about understanding people, listening to them, really trying to unpack what their drivers are, what people's context is. He was, of course, doing it for very commercial reasons. But there are many commercial reasons to use empathy and to drive that into society. So, very old book, and I still pick it up.
Amazing. Good choice.
I would bring, yeah.
Yeah. And your next one?
My next one, let's go to the bottom one. So, Sheryl Sandberg. She is just a phenomenal woman in leadership. And I think she's one of the first women that really started speaking about women in leadership and how we can be proud of what we do and how we can, you know, elevate what we do. She talks about not being afraid to have a seat at the table, and she talks about being confident in your voice and leaning in, which again, ironically, I use that term quite a lot in my own work now. Mm. Not in the same way. Mm. Cheryl's talking about, you know, leaning into business. I talk a lot about leaning into conversation, literally, physically, in order to empathize and connect with people. But yeah, she talks about this, the will to lead. And I think anyone that's gone through COVID this year and is still going has the will to lead, right? Because it's just not been easy.
No, so not at all.
I've reread it twice. So I've read it three times. Maybe I should reread it again now. Probably I could do with some more wisdom.
Yeah.
But yeah, also really important book to me.
Lean In by Sheryl Sandberg. A definite read, not just for women.
No, not just for women.
For men as well. And I think, you know, young readers as well. Young women coming up to the world of work, because obviously COVID has had an impact on that, what, you know, what young people are going to do. So great. And your last one.
My last one. Winnie the Pooh.
Who doesn't love Winnie the Pooh?
Who doesn't love Winnie the Pooh? Because I grew up on these stories, and this copy I bought recently for my little girl about a year and a half ago when she turned two. Because I wanted her, I mean, look how beautiful it is. I wanted her to have a book that isn't full of colour and cartoons and monsters and sharks and all those things. There's place for them. There's many of them in our house. But just to have this kind of really classic storytelling in her life, which is so powerfully emotive in terms of the imagination. And I think often children today don't have the opportunity to really use their imaginations, because so much is there for them in full colour, 3D, augmented reality. So we read this often. I think it stretches her. As I said, she's only three, so she has to think, because it's not full of pictures. You know, she has to think. And you know, Winnie the Pooh has some great wisdom. I always remember that they said in here, the smallest things take up the biggest parts of your heart. Which is absolutely true, right? All those wonderful small things in your life. And he also says, what does he say? He says, you're braver than you feel, stronger than you look, and smarter than you think. And I tell her that. Yeah. It's such a beautiful confidence boosting thing. And there's lots of little pieces of that in the Winnie the Pooh stories. So again, I have no idea when A.A. Milne first wrote this. Oh, here we go, 1926.
Yeah.
But stories that don't go out of style, I think. And just beautiful storytelling even today.
So. Yeah, and a beautiful keepsake for your daughter as well, and something that you could perhaps read just a couple of pages each night. Winnie the Pooh, A.A. Milne. Amazing, great choices, Mimi. Thank you so much for sharing those with me, and congratulations again, of course, on your book, Softening the Edge. And look forward to the next one. Will there be a next one?
There will. I've just started writing it. I think I'm hooked now.
Yes.
You must know this, right? Once you've done one.
Yes. So
there will be a next one, hopefully by the end of next year.
And then we can have you back on the show.
I would love to. Thank you so much for having me.
That's all from me. I look forward to seeing you next week on Karen's Bookshelf.